Stuff I like.
Stuff I like, stuff I like, stuff I like.
Do you know who that was?
Claire Green.
Claire Green, thank you.
Last week was Brandon Toy.
Wait, I'm sorry, Brandon?
Toy.
Brandon Toy?
Yeah.
All right, Brandon Toy. This was Claire Green. You guys are doing a great job. Keep them coming because we'll keep using them until you find the exact one we want. I got to talk about Philip Roth. There's no way around it. He's not my favorite novelist, but he was a terrific writer, a sensational writer, actually. He died. He is the last, I believe, of that generation of great writers. There was John Updike, Norman Mailer, obviously Tom Wolfe. Who else? John Updike, Philip, and there's one. Oh, Saul Bellow. Saul Bellow is really the big one, probably the best of all of them, I would think. And the one who has been excluded from all the conversations because he was kind of a conservative. And so he has been sort of excised from literary history, Saul Bellow. But that is the thing about Philip Roth. Philip Roth was the guy who wrote the story of Jewish intellectual America. He had in his books, he had an alter ego named Nathan Zuckerman. And so he was kind of representative of the people who ran the New York Times. So he always got these great reviews. He won all the awards and all the stuff. And he was a tremendously, he wrote tremendously beautifully. His first book was Goodbye Columbus, kind of a novella, and really powerful, really pictured and showed the kind of Jewish suburban world that he was writing about. And then he exploded with Portnoy's Complaint. And Portnoy's Complaint, when I was a kid, you had to tear the cover off it or wrap the cover up because it was so sexually explicit that, you know, it was just shocking at the time. And really, it captured the kind of frustration that exploded into the 60s sexual revolution. And that was really his big theme, was men's sexual release in the sexual revolution. It was like a prelude to Me Too. You could see it coming in reading Philip Roth. But his best book, as the best of the books I've read, I shouldn't say that because I never was a big fan of his, so I didn't read that many of his books. But the best of the books I read was American Pastoral. And the reason American Pastoral was such a good book was it was the first time, the only one of his books in which he created a character who was American. He was a Jew. All his characters tended to be Jews, but he was an assimilated Jew who just wanted to be part of America. And the story is that his daughter becomes a radical terrorist, and he just can't understand. And talk about assumptions and where the assumptions lay. It is that moment when the assumptions of the 60s and the assumptions of the 50s just tear apart from one another. And it was made into a not very good movie by Ewan McGregor and with Ewan McGregor, and Ewan McGregor plays the father. And here he is talking to his daughter who is on the verge of going bad and becoming a violent terrorist. And you can just see the two assumptions. You can see them split apart. One of them assuming that this world into which he assimilated is the good world, the good America, and her assuming that that world, that very world, is the enemy.
You want to protest the war? Protest it right here in Old Rimrock.
Why am I going to do a march around the post office?
Bring the war home. Isn't that the slogan? Look, they gave me this award. It's just a stupid plaque, but it means one thing. If you take a stand, people notice. If you oppose the war right here with all your strength, this is part of America too, you know.
Read Marx. Revolutions don't begin in the countryside.
We're not talking about revolution.
You're not talking about revolution.
You think about what I'm saying.
He says, protest. She says, that's not revolution. He says, we're not talking about revolution. She says, you're not talking about revolution. It is two generations torn apart by their different assumptions of what America is and what the proper response to the American way of life is. It really is a beautiful book. It's parts of it are so well captured if you want to know about what the 60s and 70s were like. Philip Roth, certainly a prominent American novelist. Like I said, not one of my favorites, but certainly an extraordinary talent. And the end of the novel. I mean, that generation, those guys were part of what made me want to be a novelist, that they were the guys, the stars of the arts at that time. But in fact, the novel is now kind of off in the sidelines of the American arts, and mostly it's TV where most of the good work, the really good work, is being done. The Klavan week is over. The Klavanless week begins. It's 3 days. I hope you have a great Memorial Day, as good as it can be without me, you know, being a Klavanless Memorial Day. I hope it's as good. And I hope the survivors will gather here on Tuesday. This fellow, I do not know how to pronounce his name. His name is Aesgir, A-E-S-G-I-R, which I guess would be Easter. He is Icelandic, and he has released his first English album called The Silence. The song is called Summer Guest, and I just really like the lyric, "My bird flies home from afar, brings the joy of spring to me, or the ocean's endless blue. He never fails. His path is clear and true. Let the same be said of all of us." I'm Andrew Klavan. This is The Andrew Klavan Show. I'll see you on Tuesday. Klavan Show is produced by Robert Sterling. Executive producer, Jeremy Boring. Senior producer, Jonathan Hay. Our supervising producer is Mathis Glover. And our technical producer is Austin Stevens. Edited by Emily Jai. Audio is mixed by Mike Cormina. Hair and makeup is by Jesua Alvera. The Andrew Klavan Show is a Daily Wire Forward Publishing production. Copyright Forward Publishing 2018.